see what today's secret word is, boys and girls.
Conky, the secret word, please.
Today's secret word is justice.
Remember, boys and girls,
every time you hear the secret word,
scream real loud!
Gee, that's a strange secret word.
Pee-wee, I have a bad feeling about today. I don't feel so well.
Me too, Pee-wee.
This is your team leader. We go on my signal. Air 80, are you ready to roll?
3, 2, go! Hands up, police! Hands up!
What's happening?
We have a warrant for Pee-wee Herman.
What did I do?
Let's go, Herman.
You're looking at 20 years to life.
For what? What did I do? I want to go back to the playhouse.
No more playhouse for you, Pee-wee. From now on, it's the big house.
We thought we would talk a little bit to Paul Reubens, who is Pee-wee Herman, or is Pee-wee Herman Paul Reubens? I can't figure out which is which.
I'm having trouble figuring that out myself lately.
Paul Reubens didn't mind altogether that his signature character had become ubiquitous enough in the pop culture that many people saw him and Pee-wee Herman as one and the same. He had figured out how to step outside his persona and live a life somewhat under the radar. While Pee-wee continued to install himself as a fixture of Americana, Paul indulged in an eccentric but presumably harmless lifestyle until one day in 1991, a chance encounter with the law at a porno theater in Florida shattered Pee-wee's image as a family-friendly brand.
Anyone that saw the movie where he was on his red bicycle with the flat top, that was not the image projected on this particular evening. It's my understanding he now has a goatee, a mustache, and his hair is much longer. He had a cap on, and I guess he was dressed as any normal person going to a theater for an afternoon of theater enjoyment.
Overnight, Pee-wee Herman merchandise vanished from the shelves, and a Saturday morning TV show was pulled from the airwaves. Paul himself largely disappeared for the rest of the 1990s. His scene-stealing performance in the 2001 film Blow, opposite Johnny Depp, was regarded as a comeback effort. But his momentum was stymied after he was indicted on charges of child pornography the following year. Pee-wee made a handful of scattered appearances before starring in a Netflix original movie in 2016. Paul never played Pee-wee Herman again after this.
Look at the time. I have to be going.
When Paul Reubens passed away on July 30th, 2023, after a lengthy battle with cancer, his accomplishments and his legacy were marred by his legal challenges. His efforts to keep his personal life out of the spotlight have only added to the speculation. In this video, we're going to draw back the curtain and take an in-depth look at the life and the crimes of Paul Reubens.
There was a time when I used to dance. There was a time when I used to praise. But dig me now. Baby, don't worry about it later.
Paul's father, Milton Reubenfeld, had spent his early life in upstate New York and worked as, among other things, an aerobatics instructor in the 1930s. When World War II broke out in Europe, Milton enlisted as a volunteer fighter pilot in the Royal Air Force, where he fought in several combat missions against German forces. After the invasion of Pearl Harbor, Milt served in the U.S. Air Force. He played a crucial role in establishing the Israeli Air Force and turning the tables in the Israeli-Arab conflict that followed the founding of the nation-state in 1948.
Chutzpah, I think, would be a great word to describe my father. He had a lot of chutzpah. My dad went to Israel because he was so passionate about it. He was raised an Orthodox Jew. He was passionate about Israel becoming a state.
He was recruited in New York. They wanted him to come and fly. And he said yes almost immediately and called four friends who all said yes.
It was before he was married and had a family.
they brought refugees over. Every time they went to Rome or wherever they went, each of them would bring home a girl, go through a mock marriage and bring them back to Israel.
I think my father was disappointed that he wasn't in the first mission, that there were four planes and five pilots, and he was the one who didn't go. In hindsight, one of those five pilots was killed, so I might not be here talking to you about it had it been my father. I think he was very proud of what he did.
After returning to the States, he met a first grade teacher in White Plains named Judy Rosen. The two married, and on August 27th, 1952, in Peekskill, Judy gave birth to their first child, Paul Reubenfeld. A daughter, Abby, was born the following year, and a second son, Luke, in 1958. In 1961, the Reubenfelds moved to Sarasota, Florida. The couple operated the lamplighter shop on Tamiami, while Judy volunteered as nurse at her children's school. Paul took an active interest in the theater at a young age. He was a standout at age 12 while appearing in 1,000 Clowns. Paul graduated from Sarasota High School in 1970. The same year, he had a leading role in Life with Father.
I used to work in Florida at the Oslo Repertory Theater, and I did a season of Life with Father for 3 months, and by the time we had finished the run, I was playing the second oldest teenager.
You were growing up into...
And by the time we finished the run, I had turned the character into a cartoon without even realizing it, and I was, you know, good morning, mother, hi, you know, and that was where Pee-wee's voice came from.
In March 1971, Paul was arrested in Sarasota for possession of marijuana. His bail was set at $1,000 cash, equivalent to $7,627 in 2023. While a high cash bail reflects the punitive attitudes in the legal system towards marijuana offenders at the time. At his plea hearing, the judge gave Paul a relatively lenient 2 years unsupervised probation, after which his record would be expunged. As of this writing, many sources online, including Wikipedia, confuse Paul's 1971 marijuana arrest with his later 1983 arrest for loitering, which we will cover later. The telephone game of online chatter has extended to a misperception that Paul's infamous 1989 anti-crack PSA was a condition of his sentence for a drug bust.
This is crack, rock cocaine.
The misattribution appears to trace back to a 1991 Seattle Times article.
Well, I really started out as an actor, and like a lot of comedians, wound up getting into comedy kind of through the back door. I never really thought I was going to be a comedian.
In 1977, Paul changed his last name to Reubens and moved to Los Angeles to further a career in the entertainment industry.
This just handed to me. Live from New York, it's Saturday Night!
In his first few years, NBC's Saturday Night Live had become ground zero for a new generation of comedy. And while many of the original Not Ready for Primetime players had come out of Chicago's legendary improv comedy ensemble, Second City, Lorraine Newman had come out of the Groundlings, establishing it as SNL's West Coast portal. Paul joined the Groundlings, where he began to workshop his original character, Pee-wee Herman.
It was generally a character that I just could switch on, so I guess that answers that it must be an alter ego of some kind, because I can just turn on the character and know what he thinks and know what I don't have to give it a lot of thought.
Bachelor number three is a comedian who loves listening to the radio, watching TV, and watching birds. And he's known for his ability to walk on a tightrope and do trapeze work. Meet Pee-wee Herman.
In 1980, Paul finally got his chance to audition for Saturday Night Live.
From New York, Saturday Night Live is live again. Saturday Night Live, the next generation's premiere.
As it happened, this was after show creator Lorne Michaels, as well as the entire remaining original cast, had just left the show. In a scramble, NBC promoted associate producer Gene Dumanian to showrunner. Dumanian was a socialite turned network executive with limited production experience and even more limited comedic vision. Her formula for Saturday Night Live 80 was to dial up the crudeness and the cocaine with an updated faux punk aesthetic that foreshadowed the rise of Hot Topic.
evening, and welcome to the Leather Report. Leather Weather Report. I'm your leather weather girl, Thelma Thunder. And this is our weather map.
Gilman, go free! The season was a legendary train wreck, with audiences and reviewers expressing outright repulsion at the sleazy, lazy snow job Domanian had made out of the show they had come to cherish.
Don't spoil it for me now! Does this make you sick or what?
Charlie, how are you feeling now after you've been shot?
Oh, man, it's the first time I've ever been shot in my life. I'd like to know who the fuck did it.
Charlie Rocket muttering a swear word on air in February 1981 was all the network needed to end the season prematurely.
It's like you said, it just doesn't matter.
It really doesn't matter. Hey, we're going to take care of you, huh? It doesn't matter.
And bring in GE suit Dick Ebersol to drastically overhaul the show. Though Joe Piscopo and Eddie Murphy were the only two kept on, Gilbert recovered and enjoyed arguably the steadiest career out of the rest of the fired cast. Paul continued to work on his Pee Wee Herman character along with fellow groundling Phil Hartman. By 1981, the two developed a full theatrical production.
Stand-up comics. I'm not really a stand-up comic, which is why I wound up doing the Pee Wee Herman show as kind of a play rather than stand-up comedy. I just, in fact, the character of Pee Wee Herman really evolved because I didn't know any jokes, and so it started out as a bad comic.
The Pee Wee Herman show quickly grew buzz around town when it was workshopped at the Groundlings before a 5-month sold-out engagement at the Roxy Theater. HBO filmed a performance for their series On Location, which was also released on home video.
Deeper still! How do you feel?
Late Night with David Letterman debuted on NBC on February 1st, 1982. From the outset, Dave set out to create a spontaneous and jarring atmosphere on his show. The manic chaos that Pee Wee Herman generated in the absence of heavily scripted material fit perfectly into Dave's ethos. Pee Wee's profile continued to rise through a string of appearances on Late Night.
You're not going to see anything like this, gentleman, anywhere in the world. Pee Wee Herman is here tonight.
Well, at this point, I'm thinking a lot more in terms of a movie version of it. The Playhouse is really just where Pee Wee lives, and he doesn't have a kid show. He doesn't do a television show in that. It's called Pee Wee's Big Adventure.
In my hometown, where I used to stay, down there, we have a good time. We don't talk.
Meanwhile, Paul regularly returned to Sarasota to visit family. Sarasota's vice squad had a long reputation for blurring legalities and disproportionately targeting consumers. Sarasota County Public Defender Elliot Metcalf described many of them as born-again types. While visiting in 1983, Paul left to go to the Adult Entertainment Center, an adult bookstore in the Coral Cave Mall. Rolling Stone described it as a rat hole peep show joint, selling vintage porn magazines and attracting men of all ages looking for action. Detectives reported seeing Paul in the alley behind the store, trying to open the door of a Pontiac that didn't belong to him. At 3:15 a.m., Paul was arrested for loitering and prowling. The charges were dropped a month later, thanks in part to Paul's longtime friendship with Joan Verizzo, who was working for the state's attorney's office at the time. Paul had made a deal with Warner Brothers to make Pee-wee's Big Adventure into a feature film. Paul was particularly impressed after seeing the work of an up-and-comer named Tim Burton. Burton was brought on as director, and Oingo Boingo frontman Danny Elfman was recruited to write the soundtrack. The growing public anticipation around the film was surpassed when Pee-wee's Big Adventure was released on August 9, 1985. The movie put Pee-wee Herman firmly on the map, and everyone in Hollywood wanted a piece.
I knew the guy was a genius because I'd worked with him for several years at the Groundlings.
Permission to come aboard, Pee-wee!
He invited me to join him in writing his first feature film, Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Just some characters and different things. I won't take a lot of your time.
Okay, introduce yourself.
It's gonna be along that line. I'm not sure. Okay. Hello, my name is Philip Hartman, and I'd like to introduce you to some of my characters. I was a sucker for long legs. I wanted to shinny up one of hers like a native boy looking for coconuts. She was the kind of blue-eyed blonde that Hitler based his racial theories upon. It's the latest development in the world of self-defense, the stun gun from Radco. Perfect for stray dogs or annoying solicitors, even keeps the most relentless Jehovah's Witness at bay. But that's not all. This frequency has supersonic libido amplification power. Turns any target into a mindless, writhing sex machine. Look at Bernie Brillstein go! You like impressions? I know you do. Let me introduce my favorite impressionist, the funniest man in Germany, Gunter Johann.
Danke schön, guten Abend und willkommen. Mein Name ist Gunter Johann. Wir sehen uns auf eine fantastische Impression wie sehen. Jack Benny, fantastisch amerikanischer Komiker. Jack Benny.
Nun Rochester, ich will nicht runterkommen.
Look out of his way. Here he is coming. John Wayne, look out.
Was du Leben, Papi? Der Flunker der Depth Perception Examiner. Der will nicht waffen mit der Flying Tigers.
Jack Nicholson.
Entschuldigen Sie, Frau Mulray. Wo bist du intercoursen mit du Vater? Der will nicht deine Pregnancy mit du Sister haben.
My favorite recent monologue is another Jack Nicholson piece. I'm nutty for this guy.
Phil Hartman's audition blew away SNL's talent scouts, and he clinched his spot as a repertory player for the 1986 season. Meanwhile, CBS wanted Pee-wee Herman in their Saturday morning lineup. They approached Paul with the idea of an animated series, but Paul turned this down. Instead, the Pee-wee Herman show was lightly retooled into its G-rated iteration, Pee-wee's Playhouse.
Look, Mr. Salesman!
Who you calling salesman?
Captain Carl!
Ahoy, Pee-wee!
Phil helped to develop Playhouse and appeared again as Captain Carl for the first season. Somewhere in between filming of Pee-wee's Playhouse over the summer and Phil's debut on Saturday Night Live on October 11th, the two had a falling out.
Hello!
Welcome to the set of my cool new Paramount motion picture! It's a sexy love story between me and
not one, but count them two beautiful women!
The phenomenal success of the Pee-wee Herman franchise had begun to turn on itself by the time the follow-up to Pee-wee's Big Adventure, Big Top Pee-wee, hit the theaters in 1988. Oversaturation of Pee-wee translated to underperformance at the box office. Meanwhile, the demands of being Pee-wee Herman put Paul on a back-breaking schedule throughout the rest of the 1980s. Then, in 1989, news broke that Pee-wee had gotten married.
I so wish I could move like that.
It comes from inside. The spirit moves the hands.
Did it take you long to learn?
I'm Chandi Heffner.
Chandi. That's a beautiful name. It's Harry Cushman, isn't it?
Yes. It means female energy personified.
I know.
35-year-old Chandi Heffner seemed to come out of nowhere when she was adopted by the richest girl in the world, Doris Duke, in 1988. The 75-year-old tobacco heiress and philanthropist believed Chandi was the reincarnation of Doris's only biological child, Arden, who was born in 1940 and died shortly after birth. In 1989, Chandi was introduced to Paul by Gomer Pyle actor Jim Nabors. The two reportedly fell immediately for each other, and soon after held an impromptu mock wedding ceremony at Shangri-La, Doris Duke's Honolulu home. They managed to keep their relationship out of the public eye, and it's unknown exactly how long they were together.
She's feeling as if she's got a fever. She's shaking. She feels very cold.
There's so much suffering that isn't being addressed and people aren't taken care of that I try to take care of the people who are suffering where there isn't any other option for them. I feel that God is the same to everyone.
He says she is like a god
before. Hello, I'm Pee Wee Herman.
By now, Paul had grown weary of the grind of keeping Pee Wee Herman going. He ended his contract with CBS after filming the last two seasons of Pee Wee's Playhouse. On January 17, 1990, the final original episode aired. CBS planned to air reruns throughout the summer of 1991 until its replacement debuted in the fall. Paul planned to continue making Pee Wee Herman material but hoped to branch out. He discussed several ideas with friends, but nothing concrete had come together.
Bend and spread them.
That punk's mine.
No, I saw him first. He's mine.
In my hometown, where I used to stay, down there, we have a good time. We don't talk.
Friday night, undercover Sarasota sheriff's deputies arrested Reubens at this Triple X theater on very adult charges.
He had a cap on, and I guess he was dressed as any normal person going to a theater for an afternoon of theater enjoyment.
The officer merely observed him manipulating his genitalia in the theater in plain view.
Police also say three other men were also arrested on a similar charge of indecent exposure, a misdemeanor crime that could mean up to 60 days in jail and a $500 fine for the comedian. Reubens, who grew up in Sarasota, refused to comment on the charges, but his attorney Dan Danheiser told the Sarasota Herald Tribune Sunday, quote, "He does a lot of things with kids over the world, and his career will be over when that story runs." This is not the first time Reubens has had a run-in with the law. According to police, Reubens was arrested in 1983 for loitering and prowling three blocks in the same Triple X South Trail Adult Theater. The 1983 misdemeanor charge was later dropped by the state attorney's office.
The South Trail Triple X Theater in Sarasota had begun its life as Jerry Lewis Cinema, part of a chain of single and twin screen movie theaters that popped up in the late 60s and early 70s. By 1991, it had been repurposed as an adult bookstore that showed contemporary feature-length porn films in the single-screen auditorium. On the bill the evening of July 26, 1991, was a triple feature: Nancy Nurse, Turn Up the Heat, and Catalina 5-0, Tiger Shark. Paul was back in town visiting his parents when he decided to step out and take in a movie. That night, the Sarasota County Sheriff's Special Investigations Bureau happened to be particularly bored, so four detectives were dispatched to trawl the three adult theaters in that vicinity, ostensibly for drug activity. Detective William Walters canvassed the theater in the back of South Trail. Less than a dozen patrons were present. At 8:25 p.m., Detective Walters reported witnessing one of the men pulling his penis out and stroking it with his left hand. 10 minutes later, Detective Walters reported seeing the suspect repeating the act as another movie began. The detective stepped out of the theater and leaned against a spring break pinball machine. Flanked by dildos and outsized VHX boxes, he and three other detectives walked outside the lobby. At 9:50 p.m., four men were arrested exiting the theater. One of them was Paul Reubens. Detective Walters allowed Paul to call Joan Verizzo, by then on her way to becoming a corporal with the Sarasota County Sheriff. Joan met up with Paul at the station as he was booked on the misdemeanor charge of exposing a sexual organ. She received a one-day suspension for loaning Paul $40 to cover his $219 bail.
TV cameramen agreeing to share any successes with each other tried to cover every entrance to the courthouse. Nobody told the media the sheriff's office planned to sneak Paul Reubens in. The first sight of the actor came inside the courtroom.
To accommodate Reuben's entry, deputies blocked off a fire exit, allowing him to slip in a back door right into the courtroom.
So I will ask you, if you understand, please call for your acknowledgement and waiver of rights that you have signed.
Yes.
You understand you give up all your rights in this waiver of rights form, including the right to respond?
Yes.
Does your attorney, Mr. President, Mr. Gerstein, explain everything to you, sir?
Yes.
Do you have any questions?
Yes.
The sentence, a $50 fine and 75 hours work on an anti-drug video.
This is crack.
Paul was able to be released within an hour and immediately traveled to consult with his sister, Abby, who was by then a practicing attorney in Nashville. From there, he hid out at Duke Farms, the 2,700-acre estate in Hillsborough Township, New Jersey, that Doris Duke had inherited at age 12 when her father passed away. Meanwhile, Karen Dillon, an observant young beat reporter for the Sarasota Herald Tribune, saw the name Paul Reubens come through on the police blotter and put two and two together.
Throughout the day, you know, it kept running through my mind, can this really be true? You know, it really scared me, and I just thought, you know, we're going to run a story, and what if it isn't Paul Reubens? I mean, it just didn't seem real. It seemed almost fantasy or just like a daydream, you know, because it just, why would he do this?
His mugshot quickly made its way to the front page of newspapers across the country. CBS abruptly pulled Pee-wee's Playhouse reruns from Saturday morning rotation. Overnight, Pee-wee Herman merchandise disappeared from retail shelves.
Most people have never even seen the real Paul Reubens. And so, with that picture, with the scruffy beard and, you know, his hair and, or goatee and his hair, I mean, he just looked, you know, not what anyone would expect.
Hi, boys and girls. Your friend Pee-wee has been on a new adventure, which is why it's time to buy
the new improved Pee-wee doll.
This one's even anatomically correct.
As Pee-wee Herman became a pariah and a punching bag, Paul attempted to regroup and figure out where to go from here. That year, he also agreed to appear as Pee-wee Herman at MTV's Video Music Awards.
Ladies and gentlemen, MTV is proud to introduce someone who has been a friend for a long time.
That really means a lot to me. I have...
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. All right, okay, shut up.
Now, I just have one thing that I'd like to say to all of you out here and to everyone in the nation, and that is...
Welcome to the 1991 MTV Video Music Awards!
In 1992, Tim Burton hired him for a supporting role in Batman Returns as the Penguin's father. He landed another role in 1993, Tim Burton's stop-action feature, The Nightmare Before Christmas. In 1999, his appearance alongside Ben Stiller in Mystery Men was received favorably. His scene-stealing portrayal of drug dealer Derek Forreal opposite Johnny Depp in 2001's Blow was heralded by many as a comeback vehicle.
Jeffrey, what's up, man? Looking good?
How are you wearing jeans right now, my friend?
What?
How are you wearing jeans right now? It's like 90 degrees out here.
It's about 85.
Is that pants weather to you?
What?
Apparently it's pants weather to you.
Well, it hadn't occurred to me, actually.
Well, I got shorts.
I see.
And sandals on. Well, anyway, Jeffrey, you got a court tomorrow, right, man?
Excuse me?
You have to go to court tomorrow, correct?
Are you with TMZ?
Indeed I am, sir.
Okay.
So, actually, I have the pleasure of having breakfast with you in the morning.
What?
I said I have the pleasure of having breakfast with you in the morning.
You too?
I'm going to be at court.
I didn't know.
So, I'm wondering if you, you know, want to break the ice now and talk about it. You nervous at all?
No.
They said if you're convicted, there goes my shoe.
Don't lose your shoe.
In November of 2001, the LAPD Vice Squad received a tip regarding actor Jeffrey Jones, best known for his role as Principal Ed Rooney in Ferris Bueller's Day Off. A 17-year-old male reported that Jones had solicited the minor to pose for pornographic photos over a 2-year period. After the informant mentioned the name Paul Reubens, the investigators were able to obtain a search warrant to raid Paul's Hollywood Hills home. Paul stepped away from acting in 2002 to take care of his father back in Florida, who was suffering from terminal cancer. On November 14, 2002, Jeffrey Jones was arrested on charges of solicitation with a minor. The next day, Paul was indicted on child pornography, and he immediately turned himself in with attorneys present. At arraignment, the court found insufficient evidence to move forward on a felony case. Out of the thousands of items the LAPD had seized in the raid, mostly pieces of vintage erotica, the DA could only produce a few images that could maybe be interpreted as obscenely explicit. Paul agreed to a reduced misdemeanor obscenity charge. He was required to register as a sex offender for 3 years, during which time he was prohibited from any unsupervised contact with minors.
Hey, that's Pee Wee Herman. This is great.
This will sort of illustrate who I was as a kid. I was probably 5 or 6 years old. I had a younger sister, a year younger than me. I have a younger sister, mm-hmm. a year younger than me. And she got, for her birthday or Christmas or something one time, she got a little tea set, which she was like, ugh, I don't want this tea set. I was mesmerized by the tea set immediately. I was like, you don't want this? Are you insane? What is right. wrong with you, you know?
You can serve so, miniature tea with this.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, and it was that thing. It was like the little cup this sure. big and a little tea. And so,
when Paul Reubens passed away, speculation around his sexual orientation persisted. Paul himself never publicly disclosed how he identified, leaving viewers to draw their own conclusions. While his marriage to Chandi Heffner appeared dubious at best, nothing suggested he used the relationship for PR purposes, or that studio involvement was at hand.
Anyone who's been involved in LGBTQ, civil rights, and family law over the last 4 decades has witnessed the advocacy, leadership, and tenacity of Abby Rubenfeld. Abby's record of accomplishment is amazing. She is truly a rock star in LGBTQ history.
For my whole life, I've had like this intense sense of justice, what I think is justice, and wanting to make sure that everyone gets justice.
His sister, Abby Rubenfeld, had been an LGBTQ advocate since the 1970s and was instrumental in the 2015 Supreme Court ruling on same-sex marriage. Pee Wee Herman, meanwhile, had long since been adopted as a queer-coded icon by the LGBTQ community. Pee Wee was the flamboyant ringleader of a gaudy and garish circus of camp.
Pee Wee Herman character is queer in the deepest sense of it doesn't fit in, he's a little bit odd, there's something funny going on with all the fetishization of the furniture and these odd men who live in little TV sets and make jokes and stuff.
I always knew he had a big head.
Two of his closest friends were Miss Yvonne and Mrs. Renee, both of whom were sort of motherly types who never had any real heterosexual relationship with the main characters. Cowboy Curtis is played sort of a friendly sort of cowboy who seemed more like a gay hustler almost, rather than a children's show character.
May I cut in?
Pee-wee!
so that when it became clear that when Paul Reubens did do something, that they could catch him on, although nobody ever accused him in the press, as far as I could see, of being a homosexual, that in fact it was an incipient homophobia, which they were responding to, which they had been feeling all along and had nothing to pin it on.
It's two more fruitcakes, Ronan.
He also gave outcasts of all stripes permission to be their authentic selves. In the 2016 Netflix revival Pee-wee's Big Holiday, Pee-wee meets Magic Mike actor Joe Manganiello, who convinces him to step outside his small town to experience the big city for the first time. At the end of the film, the two ride off together into the sunset.
In Cuba, they dance to my mambo. America dance to no rock. Wir tanzen nicht rock nach mambo. Wir tanzen den mambo rock. Hat einen Rhythmus, den heißen Rhythmus.
Of course, I wouldn't say the word f*** on the air. I wouldn't want to be the next Charlie Rocket.
Would you?
I'd like to now read a few things.